On behalf of the World Affairs Council, I'm very pleased to introduce tonight's distinguished guests. Michael Levi is, to me, most impressive because he has a BS and an MA in physics and a PhD in war studies, which is a rare combination. He writes and lectures extensively on climate change, on energy security, on arms control, and on nuclear terrorism. He is, as Josh mentioned, the David Rubenstein Senior Fellow at Council on Foreign Relations and also Director of CFR's Center on Climate Change. Liz Economy is equally credentialed from outstanding universities, Swarthmore, Stanford, University of Michigan. These are two very smart people. She's the Director of Asia Studies and at the Council. She is a CV Star Senior Fellow. She's Vice Chair of the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council, and her most recent book, The River Runs Black, addresses environmental challenges that are facing China, and she was widely honored and applauded for that excellent book. It's one that I commend to people who are here tonight. And she is an expert on Chinese domestic and foreign policy. The topic of the book and topic of tonight's conversation is relates to how China's resources policy is going to affect the world and how it may change the world. Right now we're looking at the population of the Asia Pacific in terms of middle class people rising from 600 million to about 3.2 billion over the next 15 years. And the question is, how will that rise of demand on food, water, energy, particularly in light of climate change, affect not only the Asia-Pacific region, but the entire world? If you talk to different pundits, you tend to get two very opposing views, one in which there is cataclysmic effects with resource wars, riots, famines, droughts, and disease plaguing the region because of unfair allocation and aggressive grabbing of resources. Another one says that the region will rise peacefully and that, in fact, there is tremendous advantage to having the interdependence that's created by the need for countries to trade in these critical resources. Rather than picking one side or the other and creating just another voice in that stale debate, this book adds a very nuanced, sophisticated analysis of those the what's really happening on the ground, the different options, and the thinking of the critical decision makers. And so we're very fortunate to have Michael and Liz here to elucidate on those issues. So let me start with the simplest question. Why did you write the book?
Well, I think there were a number of reasons why Mike and I were interested in tackling this topic, but chief among them was really that we're in the midst of one of the great transformative processes of our time, really the rise of China. And we felt that in many respects we don't have that good an understanding of the impacts of that rise on the ground. And China's resource quest is really at the heart of that rise, right? It's China, as China goes outside its border to secure resources to continue to fuel its growth, what is its impact on the global economy, on international security, and on global governance? These were the issues that engaged us and why we felt it was important, as you so kindly said, to offer a nuanced and on-the-ground look.
I hate to jump ahead to the end, but your subtitle is "How China's Resource Quest is Changing the World." So how is it changing the world?
Well, we could speak for an entire evening about how it's changing the world, and you can see consequences on everything from investment to governance to security relationships. But one of the things that surprised us when we were writing and researching the book was that the biggest consequences in a lot of ways were the ones that were least telegenic. It was the simple impact on prices. China goes out and trades. More than it goes out and invests or tries to create a political relationship with a supplier, it trades like every other country trades. And because it's so large and because it's emerged so quickly, that has enormous impacts on the price of everything from oil to natural gas to iron ore to copper. And the impact of that is felt everywhere, not just in the countries that Chinese companies do business with, but for every producer around the world, they feel that rising tide, and for every consumer. And we felt that here in the United States, even though we don't sell a drop of oil or a bit of iron ore to China.
Mm-hmm. Now, 30 years ago, people were having the same conversation about how Japan's rise was influencing commodity prices around the world and that they were going to corner certain markets and create all sorts of challenges for the for world economy. How do you see this different, the rise of China being different from what we experienced with Japan, where all the Cassandras proved to be somewhat wrong?
So why don't we start with what it has in common, and then let's talk about how it might differ. So if you go back and look at what was being written in the early 1970s through the 1980s, and what was being discussed, a lot of it sounds like the discussions that we have today about China. Here is Japan emerging not only as a large buyer of oil and ores, but also having bought on the open market through trade, eventually becoming an increasingly prominent investor. And you have the same discussions rise up about how Japan is different from everyone else. They are locking up resources. They are state-driven. They have different tools that we don't either. Very familiar lines if you pay attention to China's resource quest today. And so the first thing worth sort of soaking in from the Japanese experience is that even though there was this large country with massive demand, investing abroad, different tools from the state, 30 or so years later, we are still a market-based global system for most commodities trade. We haven't seen all the critical resources locked up. So this can turn out relatively well. How is China different? Well, first, in a lot of ways, it's similar, and we can talk about that a bit more. A lot of the warnings about how China would fundamentally transform the structures of the global market haven't come to pass. The global system is pretty resilient. But if you want to look to the future and ask how China might be different, I think you focus on a couple places. First, China's bigger. And size really does matter in this picture. Japan reached a limit. Look, the economy stalled out. But even had the economy not gone where it went, we would still not have seen the same potential that we see with China today. On top of that, Japan had all sorts of restraints when it came to the military side of things and the security side of things. Japan, for a lot of reasons, simply wasn't going to become the same kind of global power, or didn't become the same kind of global power that China certainly has the potential to become. And that's not an acute issue today in a lot of ways. China's military capacity, particularly beyond its sort of near abroad, is very limited. But as we go out into the future, the question of who will provide that physical security for resource trade is going to be a real and growing issue, and one that never really came to a head with Japan.
Well, that does seem like a significant issue and a significant difference in the sense that Japan was not growing its military capability, and it, to the extent that it was growing, it wasn't in a position to assist in the securing of resources around the world or in the dividing up the allocation of resource-rich areas, for example, the East China Sea or the South China Sea. Do you think that that will end up being a significant difference long-term in how this plays out?
Well, I think one of the things that we've found through our research is it's important to disentangle the resource quest from the security issues. So, yes, resources certainly play into China's drive within the East and South China Sea. It's assertiveness that we've seen over the past several years. But fundamentally, these are issues of sovereignty. And if you look back to the 1980s, you can find Chinese military planners, for example, talking about their plans to push out past the first island chain and to expand their military capacity and their security. And it really was not about the resources. Nobody knows what those resources are. Everything from, you know, people predict everything from about as much oil to meet China's needs for a week to as much oil to meet China's needs for a year. So the estimates, you know, vary significantly. But this really is an issue of, you know, sovereignty and of China's perceived need for security.
Now, in terms of China's security, they consider these resources essential to their long-term security. And one of the ways to ensure a proper supply is through investing around the world. Is China investing differently than other multinationals? The Chinese state-owned enterprises, are they investing in a different manner?
Well, I think you know, there's an image, right, that that China does things differently, in part because when China goes out, sometimes it goes out with President Xi Jinping, you know, going to a country in Africa or Southeast Asia or Latin America, accompanied by 10, you know, ministers and heads of state-owned enterprises and perhaps some representatives from the major banks, the Exim Bank or China Development Bank. And they pitch these vast trade aid and development deals. So you have the sense that that sort of Xi Jinping is like a conductor of a very finely tuned orchestra with each part sort of playing in harmony. But in fact, what we found is really there's much more cacophony. And oftentimes those vast trade and aid deals, state-owned enterprises don't actually want to participate. Right? Because some of what the National Development Reform Commission has designed for them will be money losing. And actually, state-owned enterprises now want to compete like other multinationals. And they have actually a pretty poor track record. You know, 80% of Chinese investment in the mining sector overseas is, you know, not profit making. So there's a different kind of picture that emerges when you look at the state-owned enterprises and how they interact with the with Beijing than you might anticipate. I think one other important point is that we tend to think that it's all these sort of state-owned enterprises, you know, marching out, you know, in sync with the government. But in fact, a large amount of Chinese overseas investment is undertaken in the natural resource sector is undertaken without any guidance from Beijing. And oftentimes, this leads to a series of problems for China when these actors don't, you know, do the right thing on the environment or labor. So it's a very different picture that emerges once you start really looking at how this plays out.
Yeah. And you know, I've been falling into a trap that I think a lot of us do, which is referring to commodities generally. But we're really talking about energy and minerals and water and These are each treated differently, and food. So how would you do you see differences in the type of activity that China's engaged in these different commodity sectors? And if so, where are they having the most impact?
So you see a host of differences, and maybe I'll flag two or three that stand out. The first is that the structure of the Chinese industry is different in each of these markets. It's different at home. And one of the things you find, and certainly that we learned as we were doing this research, is that the structure, the environment for Chinese companies at home has a huge impact on how they behave and operate abroad. And so in the oil sector at home, it's very concentrated. It's dominated by a few state-owned enterprises. And guess what? You have a few big state-owned enterprises investing in oil abroad. And that influences the level that they play at, their technical sophistication, but also the degree to which they can be influenced by the Chinese government. When you look at minerals, it's considerably less centrally controlled. You have private companies playing bigger roles alongside big state-owned enterprises. When you get down to land and agriculture, the biggest player is actually a provincially owned enterprise, okay? So not directly linked to the Chinese central government. And you have these different structures, again, different structures at home resulting in different structures abroad and a host of different modes of behavior because of that. That's the first. And the second is the physical attributes of these markets matter. When it comes to oil, you have a flexible global market. Chinese companies go out, they invest in oil in Sudan or in Angola or wherever you want, they typically ship it onto the global market to get whatever the highest prices that they can, and so they fit into the market in that particular way. When you go to the other extreme, to water, it's nothing like that. People aren't trading water around the world. These are Chinese companies trying to use water, whether it's for hydroelectricity or for irrigation, for other purposes. They're operating within China, but they're upstream of others, whether in India or in Cambodia or in Russia, that depend on the same water flows. And so the physical reality, I could go on mineral by mineral and commodity by commodity, but the physical reality of each of these matters. This is not all about abstract markets. And the last piece that is worth paying attention to is market structure. The distribution of resources and production really matters. So if you take natural gas is pretty well distributed around the world. You have a host of different suppliers. You can go out and diversify. If China invests in Mozambique, that isn't the end of the world for other countries. Rare earths is another extreme. For rare earths, China controls about 95% of the production. If China goes out and responds to the growth of a mine in California or in East Africa and says, we're buying that, and maintains that concentration and that control of the market, well, that is consequential. That has broad ramifications beyond basic economics. So that sort of distribution of resources also matters a lot for the differences between different commodities.
Now, of the ones that you mentioned, it seems to me that water is the most challenging because, for one thing, it tends to be zero-sum, and you've got water tables dropping dramatically already in China, in India. Coca-Cola just came out and said that's one of their greatest concerns in the next decade. And they're all drawing water from the same, you know, Himalayan plateaus. And the question is whether or not one country is going to play fair with the other. So how do you see China sharing water with the lower Mekong Delta?
China is one for one and one for one, which means China's one for itself, basically. China's one of only three countries that doesn't actually recognize the rights of downstream countries in terms of water allocation. And so they've been pushed very hard. And we look at three cases, Kazakhstan, India, and the Mekong, the lower Mekong Delta, so Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos, Burma, Myanmar now. The Chinese get pushed a lot by these countries to tell them, you know, what is it that the Chinese are doing, you know, in terms of how many dams are you putting on the rivers? What are you doing in terms of river diversions? What's happening in terms of pollution issues? China has very gradually, very slowly, incrementally begun to discuss technical issues with these downstream countries. But in no case that we've seen have they been willing to talk about reallocation of water resources. And you're right, a lot of this has to do with China's own sense of, you know, water scarcity. People think that the air problem is the most significant in China. It's certainly not. It's all about the water. And so that makes them probably even more reluctant to consider talking about shared rights.
Well, how do you see the China's neighbors responding to that? And are we potentially looking at real resource conflicts and possible scarcity, famines, droughts, all the parade of horribles that I laid out earlier?
Well, they don't really have much leverage in this case. China controls the headwaters, and so they're, you know, left with whatever it is that China decides to do. There are some pressures within China. There are anti-dam movements, you know, for example, non-governmental organizations that are pushing China to slow down the construction of dams on some of these rivers. But fundamentally, this is in China's hands. Do we see droughts and other things? Half of China's 50,000 rivers have dried up over the past two decades. So, of course, we're seeing, droughts and other problems in China, and as, you know, sinking water tables and other kinds of challenges. They're moving ahead very slowly in terms of trying to address their water challenges through water pricing and conservation and efficiency. Certainly not quickly enough to deal with the magnitude of the challenge at hand.
I focused on their southern neighbors, but what about Russia? and the relationship between China and Russia in terms of allocation of resources with Siberia?
Well, in part, I mean, the biggest issue is probably the timber issue, you know, in terms of the Chinese and the Russians. And, you know, there's been a lot of concern within Russia about influx of Chinese. And, you know, in fact, that's a problem that many countries face when it comes to Chinese resource development, is that it's not simply the investment, but you also get the labor going in as well. But I think initially there was a lot of, you know, illegal logging. I think the Russians have tried to push quite hard to have not simply the Chinese take the timber back to China for processing, but also to begin to push the Chinese to do more of the processing and manufacturing within Russia so that they can get more of the economic benefits. Mm-hmm. I think they've had some success with this, in part because Russia is a stronger state. And that's something else that we found, is that, you know, it takes two to tango, and those states that have stronger capacity are better able to deal with some of the more negative implications of Chinese investment than those with weaker state capacity.
So you're describing a rule of law, which sounds a little bit like contract law. You know, normally statutory law, we set rules for everyone, and then we all live by those rules. Contract law is much more, I work out whatever deal I can with you, and whatever leverage I have, I get the best deal I can, then I turn to the next person, and, you know, I'm not bound by anything from that first deal. Is that what we're seeing in terms of the rule of law over resources with China and its neighbors?
I think if you look at Chinese investment around the world, there are certainly attempts by the Chinese government to do things that way, to look for special deals and to negotiate at the highest political levels. And sometimes that works out. But the Chinese appear to be increasingly finding that that works out until there's a change in leadership. Mm-hmm. And then they're not just back to being on a level playing field with everyone else. They have these resentments that put them in a fundamentally worse position. And I think this speaks to a broader trend. The Chinese are not just going out there influencing the world. They are being influenced by it. They are learning as they go through. And I think they eventually do accept in a lot of countries that they have to play by the rules that country sets out, if that country is capable of enforcing them effectively. While we were working on the book, I traveled to Zambia to do research. And I spoke with one person who told me about a Chinese environmental impact assessment. So the Chinese government had put in place, or the Chinese government, parts of the Chinese government had put in place rules that required that if you get this kind of financing or list on that stock exchange, you need to have an environmental impact assessment. And the Zambian government had also put in place rules that said you need an environmental impact assessment. So this company submitted an environmental impact assessment, and it was approved. Only problem is the environmental impact assessment was in Chinese, and there was no one in the Zambian government who spoke Chinese. So state capacity matters enormously in whether the Chinese companies play by that sort of statutory law or get their own special treatment.
Yeah. Well, we've talked a lot about China's relations with its neighbors and on an international plane, but how is this affecting these resource challenges? How is it affecting internal China? How is it affecting local governments?
It depends, I suppose, in a couple of different ways. I mean, you know, one of the things that we've seen, as, for example, China has begun to pay more attention to its own environment, right, is that increasingly for some, you know, things like coal, right, mm-hmm. it's going out to access coal. It's trying to move, you know, coal production, you know, further west within the country. You know, there's some implications for the actual resource extraction within China, with rare earths as well. They have continually contracted their production of rare earths, mm-hmm. in part because of environmental considerations. But by and large, what you find is that local governments and the people, you know, in local areas see a lot of opportunity to go out as part of this resource quest. Again, not necessarily under the guidance of Beijing, but you know, thousands of miners, gold miners, have gone from just a few towns, a few villages in Guangdong province to Ghana, And you know, the Ghanaian government appealed to Beijing and said these miners are, you know, here illegally. They're not getting their permits legally. They're despoiling our environment. Can you please get them out of here? And Beijing said, well, we had nothing to do with their going there, actually. So no, you know, you just need to do a better job of enforcing your own regulations and tell your local chiefs not to give them permits. But then, you know, in the end, the Ghanaian government simply rounded them up and had them sent back to Beijing. But I think by and large, you know, again, when you look at the structure, as Mike was mentioning, of, say, the mining sector, which is really only a third state-owned, and then two-thirds, you know, private or, you know, locally government-owned, all of these companies want to go out and see their futures and their sort of advantages coming from part of this go-out resource quest.
It's interesting to put this response on the supply side together with the response you're seeing in China on the demand side of the equation. Because China, of course, hasn't just driven up prices for everyone else, it's driven up prices for itself. And part of the response is to try and curb China's own demand, to improve Chinese efficiency so that both so that it doesn't drive prices up even more, but also so that its economy is less exposed to the consequences of its own resource quest. And here you see a whole other set of struggles. Some of it comes from trying to rebalance the overall economy, but even in trying to get weak, inefficient enterprises to shut down, or to get more capital-intensive, high-efficiency equipment into industrial sectors, they're always they're losers from some of these, even though they are overall winners for the Chinese economy. And that's tough. So we see this sort of, you know, fits and starts of efforts to improve energy efficiency, improve resource efficiency. And if you look out at the future of China's resource quest and its consequences for the world, the success or lack thereof of China's efforts to reform on that demand side of the equation are probably as consequential as any other sort of uncertainty looking out at the future.
Well, you're describing a lot of different motivations, incentives, and groups within China in this space. Is there a substantial group that is focused on environmentally sustainable, environmentally responsible acquisition of resources? Is that part of the debate that's going on internally among the population?
No doubt. I mean, part of that is emanating from Beijing, which, as Mike mentioned earlier, has begun to put in place regulations and strictures trying to encourage their enterprises to do the right thing, whether we're talking about the environment or you know, labor and safety guidelines. And saying things like, you know, unless you undertake an environmental impact assessment, you can't get, you know, money from China Exim Bank, or you can't do an IPO on the Shenzhen Stock Exchange. So some of that's coming from the central government. Some of it's coming from the bottom up, from non-governmental organizations. There are environmental NGOs that have traveled, for example, to Burma, Myanmar, undertaken studies and come back and told Chinese firms, you know, you need to do a better job of engaging with local communities. It's not enough simply to, you know, strike a deal with local officials. You know, you have to take into account the interests and concerns of the people on the ground, or you're going to face a backlash, which they, of course, have already faced. And in part, what we see is Chinese firms themselves are learning. So, for example, in Peru, some of the early Chinese entrants into the mining industry, you know, were at the bottom of the barrel when it came to labor, safety, to pay, and to the environment, certainly, and for over a decade and a half have faced a series of protests. In fact, even today, they're facing protests. But the later entrants from China have learned from that experience, and they've hired Western CEOs, or they've hired local officials or business people to work on community relations. And so they're taking advantage of the mistakes of their predecessors and trying to do a better job, in part because they want to compete on the world stage. They want to do business in the United States or Australia or Canada, and they know that if they're going to compete at that level, they're going to have to up their game.
There was a lot of criticism of China coming out of Copenhagen about what was seen as Chinese intransigence and disrupting the effort to have an international agreement. First, do you think the criticism was fair? And since then, what has the international community done, if anything, that has shifted China's approach?
I think we would do better on climate if we move past sort of fighting over how badly we screwed up Copenhagen and who screwed it up. No one shined particularly at that meeting. Certainly, the Chinese government did not come in prepared for the level of criticism and the level of frustration with its approach that it saw. And in the end, that's, I think, part of why it agreed to a few pieces at the close of the conference, even though it then tried to pull back away from those. If you look back at the last 5 years or so, though, I think you find that it's not the big international summits, and frankly, it's not the appeal directly to climate that motivates China to take stronger action. First, the primary driver of efforts within China to be more efficient in its use of resources and shift to lower carbon sources is going to come from inside. It's going to be discovering opportunities to make the economy stronger, to improve national security, while at the same time shifting to a lower carbon path. I think we've also found that diplomatically, the opportunities to work together really come on concrete measures where we can understand what exactly needs to be done, and there can be confidence in the ability to deliver on the objectives. So rather than saying we'll cut our emissions by this much, who knows if we can succeed, we'll go back and try to crank this big economy, we're seeing things like agreement to phase out HFCs, a very intense global warming gas between the United States and China, again, a practical measure you can achieve. Or technical cooperation that could actually make a lot of difference on the technology front. So you see US-China cooperation on electric vehicles. And not saying, well, I'm going to set this goal and you're going to set that goal, but saying, hey, let's get together and agree on standards for our charging systems so that if I make an innovation in the United States on electric vehicle charging, you can take that in China and build on it. And then someone else in the United States can build on that. So making that system work properly, I think that's where the more constructive collaboration is coming, helping build on the technology front, on the capacity front, rather than trying to strike these grand global deals. And by the way, that applies more broadly to a lot of these resource challenges. I mean, Liz talked about a really important phenomenon. The Chinese companies are changing their behavior, not just because more people are telling them to, but because they're gaining the tools to do it more effectively. There are those locally trained managers. There are consultants they can go to better engage with the community. The tools are there. And I think across the board, that's an important thing to keep in mind. Helping work with them to have the tools there for better performance is at least as important as they're trying to set the standards from the top down.
Now, for decades, the United States has criticized that our overdependence on oil from the Middle East caused us to use an Australian phrase, blink away conduct by countries that we would otherwise have criticized or condemned or taken different actions on. There are people who are raising the same concerns now about China, China's dependence on resources from South Sudan and how they have worked with currently, they have a high percentage of oil concessions that they've taken with Iraq. How do you see China becoming compromised in its international policy by its resource needs?
Let me say a word and then let Mike also chime in on this. I think China has a stated policy, a couple of stated policies that drive it, its broader foreign policy, irrespective of whether there are resources or not. Namely, we don't mix business with politics, and we don't meddle in the internal affairs of other countries. And so whether we're looking at China's engagement in resource-rich countries or how they approach something like North Korea, that's really a defining feature of Chinese foreign policy. It has caused them problems, clearly. It causes them problems within the broader international community. And as Mike alluded to earlier, it causes them problems when there are leadership changes in a country like Burma, Myanmar, where China was doing business. And let's face it, other countries were also doing business. But China takes a lot of the heat in places like Sudan, for example, where India has also been active. I mean, yeah. It's one of the interesting things we found in our research is that You know, wherever China is, oftentimes India is right there too, but for some reason China is the lightning rod for all of the negative, maybe because it's on the Security Council, but for a lot of the negative attention, a lot of the negative press. But I think, you know, whether or not China's engaged in the resource quest in a country, it has this sort of set of foreign policy principles that basically justify inaction in a range of potentially crisis situations.
I'd only add to that in a couple small ways. I think first, it's really important to be disciplined in separating the trade piece from the investment piece. It's not so difficult to shift the country you buy resources from, particularly, let's say, in oil, where you have a very flexible market. It's much more difficult to have invested a lot of money on the ground in a resource-producing business and then have a relationship fall apart and have it expropriated or be unable to continue to produce from it. So China is trading and it's investing, just like the United States did both, and it's the investments that are going to tend to cause the bigger political entanglements. And the second piece is that in at least some places, as China gains more experience, it's finding that it may want to separate business from politics, but it's not always able to. And it's finding, for example, in South Sudan, that it might want a hands-off approach, but that hands-off approach seems to be leading to its inability to get the oil it produces out of the country, because pipelines can't be built and the North and South can't agree. And so that forces some tough conversations within China about how to deal with these sorts of situations. It, in some ways, it becomes less tenable to stay out when you're pretty much everywhere.
Do you think that right now, in either the trade or investment spheres, state-owned enterprises have an advantage over American businesses in competing for the same markets?
I mean, I think in some cases you can see advantages because Chinese firms, often state-owned firms, have access to low-cost financing as well as low-cost labor that American firms don't. I think clearly as well, there are times when Chinese firms engage in backroom deals. They don't have the equivalent of our Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. They have something a little bit like that, but it doesn't actually have any enforcement mechanism to it, monitoring or enforcement mechanism to it, so it's really without any teeth. So I think the answer is clearly yes. There are cases where Chinese firms are advantaged, both structurally because of the low-cost labor and financing, but also, I think, because of their willingness sometimes to not operate transparently, to engage in some corrupt practices.
Well, some people have interpreted the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is currently, originally it started as the Coalition of the Willing. It was only a handful of countries with relatively modest economies except for the U.S. and Australia. Now it's grown to include Mexico, Canada, Japan. Korea has now expressed interest in getting in, and it could be, you know, well over 40% of the world's GDP. Some people have said that the Trans-Pacific Partnership may be an attempt to create a rules-based multinational ethic in trade in the region that would sort of force China to come into line with that kind of a regime over time, because it's just too big a market to ignore and to sort of raise its standards on things like foreign corrupt practices. What's your opinion on whether that's a fair statement, and secondly, what are the prospects?
Well, I don't think that was the original intent of the TPP, right? That wasn't why those four small countries began the process, and the United States jumped in and has been pushing it so aggressively. In fact, I think our greatest concern now is whether we're going to be able to find the will to sign the agreement. But that aside, I think what's been interesting is that, you know, with the initial announcements of the TPP and the big push, and as more and more countries began to join, you know, what came out of China was that this TPP was really an effort to contain China, right? That it was a competitive agreement to something that China was pursuing, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And but increasingly, there are actors within China who see it as an opportunity, much as you described, to raise the standards within China, right? So much along the lines of what happened in the late 1990s with Premier Zhu Rongji and China's entrance into the World Trade Organization, that Trans-Pacific Partnership can be a source of international pressure on domestic actors, recalcitrant actors, to get them to operate at higher standards. So there's a lot of interest now within China in some places like the Ministry of Finance and other places in trying to push forward with China's own economic reform process in ways that would allow it over time to join the TPP.
Another question that comes up often is the demographics of China. The standard line that people used to ask, the question people used to ask is, will China get rich before it gets old? How does the changing demographics of China, as the population ages, in addition to the major increase in the middle class, how will that affect their resource needs and their resource approach?
Maybe I can talk a bit about the middle class and then hand over on demographics.
Thanks.
I'll leave the tough question. The impact of a move to the middle class, which goes together with urbanization, is going to have different impacts across different commodities, and this comes back to this this distinction that you set up earlier. So as you urbanize, you're certainly going to see a lot stronger growth in demand for industrial materials. So you need to build cities, you need steel, so you need iron ore. You need copper in order to have electrical wire. So that piece continues to grow strong. You have effects that work in both directions when it comes to energy. And so when you look at forecasters' projections, they tend to find that energy demand isn't nearly as sensitive to the composition and the sort of nuances of Chinese growth going out in the future. And the piece that probably is the least consequential, or the least where that distinction has the least influence, is on food. And for a couple different reasons, part of which is internal China, but more broadly, food is the one place where you have demand growing strongly around the world, and where China isn't nearly as big of a piece of the puzzle when it comes to the future scarcity of food and future food prices as it is on these other fronts. So you have different phenomena across the different commodities.
I guess I would only add one of the interesting things when we're thinking about rebalancing the Chinese economy and developing this more urbanized economy, you tend to believe that somehow it's going to be necessarily more efficient. But in fact, urban residents use 4 times the energy and 3 times the water that rural residents do. And so as we project out and think about 300 million more Chinese being urbanized over the next 20 to 30 years, which is the game plan in China, we might expect that they are going to have, you know, increased demand for energy and increased demand for water unless they begin to take some pretty serious steps to improve their water conservation and efficiency. You know, as far as the demographics are concerned, I'm not really exactly sure how the fact that, you know, they're predicting, you know, a population of, you know, 30% over the age of 60 by 2050 will actually affect their resource quest. I guess I'd have to think about that a little bit more.
Well, what you're describing, though, is exponentially greater demand, even than the dramatic rise in than the rise in population or the rise in the middle class, because middle class people consume higher input foods, and so they're going to go through a lot more water. They're going to use more energy because they're going to have TV sets and tablets.
Absolutely.
And cars just like everyone else, and single family houses and all the things that sort of define middle class aspirations.
Right.
So the U.S. right now sees that as a great opportunity for us, because we're getting a much bigger consumer market to buy things and to trade with. Is the U.S. more afraid of China's failure than its success?
Well, I think if we're simply looking at the economy, then absolutely. I think the United States has much more to gain from China's economic success than it does from any sort of real slowdown in the Chinese economy. I think the question is then, you know, what does China do with the spoils of that economic success? And, you know, do we care that, you know, the most recent, you know, meetings have announced that they are going to be increasing their, you know, size of the military by, you know, 12.2% this year. And we've constantly seen sort of double digit, you know, increases in Chinese, you know, military expenditures, you know, which a growing economy allows them to do. And, you know, I think until when and if we have a stronger military to military relationship, you know, that is a source of concern, you know, for us. So, you know, certainly I think, you know, growing Chinese economy, you know, benefits China, clearly has benefited the rest of the world. I mean, if you look at our resource quest, you know, China is responsible for the rejuvenation of many commodity-rich economies and certainly has had a huge impact in Australia,
yeah.
You know, where you've just returned from. So, you know, that's all for the good. But I guess, again, you know, how China plans to use its growing wealth, you know, I think we need to pay attention to that as well.
The shape of economic growth is going to matter as well. When you talk about massive increases in energy consumption, if that's driven by coal-fired electricity, it's very bad for the world on the environmental front, but it also means that the knock-on effect for global commodity prices is relatively limited because China is going to tend to expand its domestic production of coal to go with that. You don't have a huge impact on markets for natural gas. Oil is a totally separate world because it feeds into transportation rather than into electricity generation. So the sort of details of how that all works out matter a lot. Now, if China were to decide that not only is it going to shift from coal to natural gas, but it's going to do that on the back of a lot of imports, then you would see much larger consequences for the global resource game. So again, the details of how China chooses to shape or is successful in shaping its domestic economy has big knock-on effects for the resource game more broadly.
I think you described how China is trying to address this challenge, that depending on how they generate energy, they could do so much damage to their environment that they're not able to really capitalize on their success. Do you have recommendations for things that China ought to be doing that it isn't doing?
you mean when it comes to their sources of energy and how they're dealing with their environmental you know, challenges? I think, you know, as we're looking at China confronting, you know, this air apocalypse as they're calling it, you know, across the eastern seaboard. You know, they've announced a number of different strategies to try to address that. You know, one of the strategies is simply moving a lot of the coal-fired power plants and production from closer to the coastal provinces, you know, further west. I don't find that to be a particularly useful way to address the challenge long term, you know, simply shifting the pollution, which is something they've done traditionally, in any case, simply moving polluting factories outside of the major cities. But I think, you know, what it boils down to in China, 9 times out of 10, is implementation and enforcement. And, you know, China has modeled a lot of its laws and regulations on the United States, on Europe and others. There are extensive efforts at bilateral, multilateral cooperation on the environment. What China really needs to do is put in place the incentives or the disincentives that make it easy for local officials and for companies to do the right thing when it comes to the environment. And so I think that's what we're waiting to see, because all of the announcements and pronouncements that they're making these days with regard to the environment are, for the most part, meaningless until we see the actions that they're taking on the ground.
Yeah. Well, if you just compare the U.S. and China right now, most people will acknowledge that the U.S. is not going to build a new coal-fired power plant anywhere again. However, China is still continuing to buy brown coal and coking coal at a ferocious pace from Australia and from other sources.
Right.
So what does that say about, you know, how well these goals are going?
Well, look, the fundamental difference on that front between China and the United States is that we have found a much cheaper way to generate our energy, and it happens to be lower emissions and more environmentally friendly. We've had this breakthrough on shale gas. And so one of the things that China is going to have to look at is not just how it secures energy abroad, but how it develops its own sources of energy at home. So there's a lot of speculation and buzz around the potential for China to develop its own shale resources. There are a lot of challenges. It's more expensive. They don't have water in the right places. They don't have pipelines to get this out. It's not close to demand centers. The shale itself may be lower quality. So there are all sorts of reasons why it might be tougher. But at the same time, they pay a lot more for imported natural gas than we pay for ours. So they're competing with a sort of an easier target. So they're going to continue to do that. Now, how are they learning to pursue that? They're learning by coming in and investing alongside U.S. companies in this country as they extract shale gas. So they are coming in and doing joint ventures. The big companies are coming in, doing joint ventures on particular pieces of acreage, helping us boost our own supplies in ways that we wouldn't be able to otherwise because the capital isn't there. And at the same time, they're learning about the technology. They're learning about how you manage these places. They're not doing this because it's going to be shipped back out to China. They want to ship the expertise and the understanding back to China. So when you ask about what they should do, they should be looking at other sources. But for us, part of what that means is we should be making sure that they can come in here, sticking to the right standards and behaving in the right way, but that they can come in here and learn how to do that because it benefits not only them, but us in the long run if they can make that kind of transition.
There's a criticism of China that it has been drawing on other nations' innovations, particularly U.S. innovations, but not developing its own centers of innovation within China. Do you think that's a fair criticism? What did you learn during the course of your analysis of their resource quest around the world and how they were innovating?
Look, I think one of the central objectives of this leadership is to move China from being a manufacturing nation to an innovation nation. They've made that very clear, and they've put in place a number of policies to try to drive that home. For example, a global 1,000 talent program, right, to bring a lot of primarily Chinese, but not necessarily, top scholars, engineers, scientists, and others back from abroad, to lure them back with these great packages, research opportunities and housing and financing and all of this. So that's just one strand of, what they're trying to do. They're pouring money into R&D. And if you look at the numbers that come out, the number of patents and all this kind of thing, far surpass now, most other nations. But most people will say they're second-order patents. It's not true innovation. For China to become an innovation nation, I think, most scholars agree that they need to have better protection of intellectual property rights. They need to reform their educational system to promote creativity and innovation. And they need to think about what they're doing in terms of cracking down on the internet, on transparency and the free flow of information, because that is at heart, the essence of innovation, right? The free exchange of ideas. And yet this particular Chinese leadership is moving in the opposite direction. And so, while they're pushing forward on a number of programs and policies and investment to drive innovation, I think a lot of what they're doing in terms of their political infrastructure is moving the country in the opposite direction.
We were talking before about the advantages Chinese companies have, and this is a place where they're at a disadvantage. They often do need to work alongside Western companies or buy supplies from Western companies to be able to operate at that high technological level. And that's a source of leverage for the United States and for other developed countries. There's a lot of worry when we put sanctions against investment in oil and gas in Iran that Chinese companies just come in and backfill. And some of that happened, but there were some strong limits in part because the Chinese companies found that they couldn't either tackle the technically challenging fields without Western cooperation or because they needed this or that high tech component that they could only source, let's say, in Europe, which happened to have sanctions against Iran. So this technological lag from China remains one of the sources of leverage and advantage that the United States and other developed countries still have.
We're going to have time for about three more questions. One thing that you've mentioned a couple times is rare earths and China's being resource rich in rare earths. Apparently, rare earths aren't that rare. It's just they're hard to mine. You have to use teacups instead of bulldozers. But during a dust-up of a couple years ago with Japan over the Senkaku Islands, the China actually cut off its sales of rare earths to Japan. Could you comment on the diminishing global supply of certain rare earths, and some of which are predominantly located in China, and how that's a factor?
Well, so there's certainly constraints to production in the short run, but you're actually seeing a pretty robust market response from around the world. Now, you can get technical, so rare earths are not actually rare, as you say. Heavy rare earths are rarer than light rare earths. We have a lot of light rare earths in the United States. So you're seeing development of those here. You're also seeing development of mines in Canada and Scandinavia and East Africa. So you're seeing this market response. You're also seeing technological innovation, people looking for substitutes for rare earths, so there isn't the same level of pressure. This is actually a case where in the short run, there was certainly this risk and this potential to do damage. But in the longer run, if we make sure that the market can respond effectively, we should get to a place where China doesn't have anywhere close to the potential leverage that it did a couple years ago. Now, that doesn't mean that policymakers can, you know, turn off the lights and go to sleep. If Chinese firms come in and buy up some of these heavy rare earth deposits and it takes another 10 years to bring another one online, that's a real window of vulnerability that gets created. And so you've seen in Australia, one of the very small numbers of Chinese purchases that got nixed was a rare earths purchase. And you'll see that elsewhere if the Chinese make the mistake of trying to buy up too many of these rare earths deposits. So policymakers need to pay attention and make sure that we get a sort of declining market concentration. But beyond that, this is actually a story of the global system being pretty resilient and the difficulty of using resource control as an instrument of national power.
Yeah, we've talked quite a bit about China in terms of pragmatic, rational decision-making, but all nations are influenced to some extent by their culture, their history. China's approach to resources and sovereignty sometimes appears to be, at least to some, to be influenced by its own historical experiences, particularly the Opium Wars. And there's a sense of a long-standing exceptionalism that people believe about China. Are there, first, if you could comment on that, and then are there other sort of cultural norms that may influence China's decision-making that don't necessarily fall down the sort of bottom-line analysis of, you know, where can I get the most critical resources at the lowest price, and I'll do what I need to accomplish that?
Well, one of the interesting things that we found when we looked back through Chinese history, a couple thousand years, but mostly, probably since the Ming Dynasty, roughly 700 years, is that there's really a lot of very strong continuity in the way that China conducts its resource quest. And so you find that, dating back to the Ming, Peking, very much wanted to control the resource quest, right, to determine, who would participate in the quest, where the traders could go, how much profit that could be realized by each part of the Chinese apparatus, what could be grown within China, in fact, right, not tobacco, rather have grain. And also a deeply rooted sense of resource insecurity, particularly with grain. And that is something that we track throughout the story that we tell, is this feeling of vulnerability and this desire not to be overly reliant on global markets. Recently there was a discussion that's just come out of China, sort of opening itself up more to being reliant on the international market for, grain and for foodstuffs. This is a pretty major shift in some respects, because again, this is a very deeply rooted sense that they want to be self-sufficient and not rely on others. So I think that that's part of what we've discovered through our research is that there are these strong lines of continuity. As far as the sense of victimization and the Opium Wars, I don't know exactly how that plays out in terms of China's, outward quest for resources. I think it's a big part of China's overall approach in terms of its foreign policy, right? But I don't know that we saw very directly an impact you know, in terms of its feelings of vulnerability, except perhaps the extent to which it doesn't want to rely on others, and that it does want to pursue an investment and have sort of, you know, direct sources of access to resources.
Well, in the minute that we have left, you did an extraordinary amount of research in connection with this book. You traveled all over the world to places in which China has very strong resource interests. You studied Chinese policy and policymakers in depth, and you looked at the different markets. What surprised you most as you were completing this work?
What surprised me most was how little control the Chinese government can often have. When I was in Zambia, I met with the Chinese ambassador there. They had had enormous problems with a Chinese coal mine. And he said to me, I keep asking the guys who run the coal mine to come in so we can sort this out, and they refuse to come for a meeting.
And I think what surprised me most probably was just the extent to which everything that we saw China doing at home, we saw them doing abroad. And so when I was in Brazil and talking to officials there, they'd say, well, you know, we have all these problems with the Chinese because they come here and they, you know, expect us just to be able to sign away our land, right? The Chinese are going there, they want to grow soybeans. And we tell them that's not how we do business here. But that is how they do business in China, right? Backroom deals between local officials and local business people illegally expropriating land. And so for me, I was just, it was fascinating to see, you know, across the full spectrum of issues, the labor issue, the environment issue, the sort of transparency issues, that how China behaved at home was really exactly what we saw them doing when they went out.
Yeah. Absolutely fascinating. On behalf of the World Affairs Council, I just want to thank both of you. Mike Levi, Liz Economy, you did not disappoint at all. If our audience could thank our two extraordinary panelists.